Getting the roof trusses into a building is a satisfying milestone. You are really making progress. You can see the shape of the finished building. But if it goes wrong, it goes very wrong. Erecting trusses can be hazardous, and any collapse can be expensive to fix, and it takes time and money to put right. And worst of all, people can be injured.
There's been some guys go off overhangs, another guy who went through some trusses, who leant on a truss that wasn't nailed off properly and went down through and landed on the ground. And he ended up fairly badly injured.
Until recently, there has been no specific practical guide available to assist you erect trusses safely. Now there is. This industry safety standard provides practical assistance for principal contractors, the people who erect trusses, suppliers of trusses, crane operators, owner builders, and other building contractors. It is a guide that has been developed by builders and roofers and manufacturers, and is based on the best advice possible.
They're coming up with a framework or a set of guidelines for frame and carpenters to work within, and a practical framework, so we actually have a greater chance of actually trying to achieve compliance.
It's a balance between what the regulators would want for precise, absolutely safe, no one can possibly get injured, and the practicalities of installing trusses in a fashion that won't cost the earth. So you've got to work that balance in between speed and safety. And I think the code forms a reasonably happy medium between the two, if you like.
The occupational health and safety legislation requires us to control risks to health and safety. The safety standard is all about managing risk when we erect trusses. If we follow this industry safety standard, we can comply with the law. The basic aim of this video, based on this standard, is to show you how to erect trusses safely, every time. The idea is to identify the risks and manage them so that everyone is safe all the time, and so everyone goes home every day. Simple to say, but hard to do.
Looking at a safer way working at heights is really important, because the more we look at that, the more we find better ways of doing things. Hence, we can reduce the number of injuries and fatalities. And at the end of the day, WorkCover would like to see every worker is able to go home to their family.
If we really want to make sure we safely erect trusses, we have to go back in time. Like most important issues in construction, success ultimately comes down to planning. A critical part of planning is communication. You have to consult properly to construct properly.
Setting up on the top plate, passing the guy on the ladder.
The principal contractor should consult with you, the people erecting the trusses, to ensure that work is planned and scheduled to minimise disruptions and situations that could affect safety.
I've been building for 34 years. In that 34 years, I've never had a fall from a roof, because I plan things before I go, make sure I can't fall, and then make sure that there is nothing underneath me if I do fall. An unstable area is a dangerous area.
You should discuss the loading and unloading sequence of the trusses at the factory and on site. This can have a big impact on reducing manual handling risks.
Our safety standard, like with a lot of current legislation, puts a lot of focus on planning. Planning the activity from the get-go.
You should discuss the size and type of crane required to lift the trusses. And you should discuss the access and safe positioning of the crane and whether you need a dogger. Discuss the perimeter scaffolding you need on site. Discuss the weather. Will it change the site conditions? Discuss the manual handling risks. Are there unusual, heavy, or awkward frames or trusses? Is there difficult access?
There is risk on all building sites, so you got to minimise the risk. So you get on site, show what the risks are, point them out to your workers so they know where the hazards are, where the risks are, so you're minimising your effect. If you go on site and the fellas don't know there's hazards or risks there, they'll go in that area.
Yeah, right, I'll take the airline off and we'll pull the battery out of
it. Do you work from a plan or do you actually go to site for us, or a bit of both?
One of the best ways to work safe is to make sure everyone has had the right training. So before starting work, everyone erecting trusses must have done basic training.
Compliant with legislation is that we have to provide...
Everyone must induction. Have completed OHS general induction for construction work. You have to have completed a work activity induction, and you have to complete a site-specific induction. And you have to consult with the people erecting the trusses in preparing the safe work method statement. The place where you are going to work needs to be assessed. Every site is different, so every site assessment will be different. Different hazards and different solutions. The safety standard recommends you assess each work site. The principal contractor and the people erecting trusses must undertake a site risk assessment prior to commencing work, and all significant hazards must be identified, assessed and controlled. Site hazards includes such things as high work areas, heavy or difficult loads, electric power, sun, heat, rain, slippery surfaces, power tools, and so on. You search the site for the hazards, and there are usually quite a few. The next step is to work out which of the hazards pose the greatest risk. One of the biggest hazards in erecting roof trusses is that you have to work at heights. It may only be a few metres, but a fall from that height can kill you. That is a hazard. And because you're erecting heavy trusses on top of the walls a lot of the time, the risk is high. Now you have to work out what you are going to do to reduce the risk of those hazards being a problem. You can reduce the risk by reducing the number of people who work at heights. That's risk management. Identifying the hazard, assessing the risk, and controlling the hazard. We have to make sure all our plant and equipment is working properly and is used safely. We have to examine our electrical plant, ladders and ramps, power tools, including pneumatic tools, cranes, scaffolding and roof edge protection. Preparation. You've checked that everyone has training and you have identified the hazards on each work site and worked out how to assess and control the hazards. And thirdly, you've made sure that the plant and equipment is working properly and is used safely. All this before we lift a truss. Good planning is a powerful tool for safety. It only takes one mistake and you have a catastrophe. You can use several safe methods to erect roof trusses. If the size, weight, and positioning of the roof trusses pose a risk to health and safety, then a crane with a certificated operator must be used. The first method is to use a crane if the erection height is too great or trusses too large for manual handling. The trusses must be craned into position, laid flat, and suitably supported prior to erection. Where trusses cannot be self-supporting, use temporary props or internal walls for support. You must ensure that all wall frames are sufficiently braced to withstand loads during construction. You can lift the trusses by hand if they are lighter or the lift is lower. Separate the smaller trusses for single-story roofs from the pack. Lift them individually into position along the top plates. If the truss needs to be repositioned, you should do this from below to avoid working at heights. The trusses are in position. Now comes the crucial phase of erecting them. And these are the recommended methods of erecting trusses. The critical stage is erecting the first two trusses. Think it through first. Erect the first truss at the location specified by the roof manufacturer. Now you can erect, fix and brace the first and second truss in several ways. One method is to use a crane to lift and position trusses. Set up an appropriate working platform no greater than 2 metres from the floor at each end where the truss is to be fixed to the top plate. Or use a ladder. If a perimeter scaffold system is installed, work from the outside. Fix temporary braces to solid fixing points ready for connection to the truss. The braces can be timber of adequate size and length, fixed by nails. Guide the first truss into position while supported by the crane. Use a minimum of 2 people, one at each end, to fix the truss to top plates and to the temporary braces. At this point, the first truss should be in a stable condition. Erect the second truss using the same procedure. Temporarily brace the second truss to the first truss. Another method is to lift the trusses into position manually. Set up an appropriate working platform not greater than 2 metres from the floor level at each end where the truss is to be fixed to the top plate, or use a ladder. If a perimeter scaffold system is installed, this work can be done from the outside. Now, fix temporary braces to solid fixing points ready for connection to the truss. The braces can be timber of adequate size and length, fixed by nails. Fix skid blocks to the top plate at first truss position to prevent the truss from slipping during standing. Use a minimum of 2 people, one at each end, to stand the first truss. A third person may be required at mid-span to assist in stabilising a long-span truss. Additional roof trusses are not to be erected unless the prescribed fixing, bracing, and any additional support requirements have been undertaken for the first and second truss. Each subsequent roof truss is placed, with each end of the truss controlled by a person on the working platform or ladder. A third person at the apex may be required to assist. Each subsequent roof truss is fixed and braced according to the manufacturer's specifications using safe methods for working at heights. Temporary ties or bracing for roof truss erection should be fixed according to Australian Standard AS4440, installation of nail-plated timber roof trusses. This standard requires that temporary ties be used on the top cords at spacings no greater than 3 metres and at spacing no greater than 4 metres on the bottom cord. If the person erecting trusses is to be supported by the bottom cords of the roof trusses, the ties or bracing must be no more than 3 metres apart. All bracing and fixing should take into consideration or impose loads during the course of construction. As such, flat strapping or an equivalent, or trimmers nailed to the face of trusses, where the nailing is from the outer face of the truss, must not be used. We should use safe work methods to erect gable roof assembly and verge truss assembly. Diminishing truss, verge trimmers, gable studs or droppers. Where practical, elements of the roof structure should be pre-assembled on the ground as a complete unit and lifted onto the supporting structure. Girder boots, hangers and the like should be installed to the manufacturer's specifications prior to working in the truss space. There are many serious hazards working at heights. This is probably the most important message of the safety standard. To erect trusses, you have to work at heights. The main thrust of the safety standard is to allow erectors to walk the trusses under controlled conditions. When trusses are erected at up to 600 millimetre centres, you can, under controlled conditions, use the bottom cords of erected and braced trusses as access and fall protection. At no time is any person to stand on or work from an external wall top plate without suitable fall protection. You can use trusses, but a no-go zone applies. No one can work in the area of the erected framing where the height from the top of the bottom cord to the top of the top cord is less than 900 mils. No one can work within 1.2 metres of the outside wall top plate.
If you're any closer than 1200, when you fall, you're past your waist and you'll end up going straight over the roof. So always work 1200 back off the plate, which is a zone where if you fall, everyone's from feet to waist is about 1200. So you will not go straight over. It is a catch zone where you can grab hold of the plate or land on the plate and save yourself.
Staying in a position where you can't fall out of the building or can't fall through into the building is the key of the no-go zone.
To manage the risk of falls, you have to follow the following conditions. Have the trusses braced at a maximum of 3 metres. You have to be a competent person, fully trained, to walk the trusses. You have to have suitable footwear that provides a good foothold. You need to be supervised by a competent person from the erection team. The bottom cord has to be checked for defects. Erecting trusses is different from a lot of other work in construction, but the risk of falling is ever present and has to be managed. This way of using the trusses for fall protection is practical, but you have to follow the guidelines to make it safe. Some trusses are tall and you have to work near the top. If the apex or other high bracing points cannot be reached, use whaling plates to reach the apex or high points. Fix whaling plates for standing or supporting temporary work platforms at the appropriate height. The whaling plate should be fixed to the face of the truss according to the manufacturer's recommendations to ensure the load is transferred to the bottom cord. The whaling plate should be timber of 70 by 35 millimetre F5 or equivalent to a maximum of 1500 millimetres long, fixed at each end by a minimum of 265 millimetre by 3.15 millimetre nails. If we are using ladders for access, they should have non-slip feet and be secured against displacement. There should be a safe landing place when stepping off the ladder, and the top of the ladder should extend 1 metre above the landing place. You can use timber railings installed at the point of manufacture. You can install temporary studs. Temporary timber handrails should be checked for their quality and their effectiveness to prevent falls. We can use scaffolding as good edge protection on low pitched roofs, providing the guardrails of the scaffolding extend at least 900 mil above the roof. All scaffolding over 4 metres needs to be constructed by a qualified scaffolder and comply with standards. The first floor perimeter edge protection must not be removed until all openings and penetrations are otherwise protected. Temporary timber handrails should be checked for their quality and their effectiveness to prevent falls. Where a void exists, no one is to work on the first floor or above unless a void protection system is installed. If you want to be safe all the time, everyone has to be trained and qualified and consulted. You're going to rely on each other. Others rely on you. You have to know what you're doing. So you all need training and qualifications. Manual handling heavy loads around building sites can affect our working lives, and it shouldn't. We should be able to do our work and stay safe. So, what should we do about eliminating or reducing the hazards of manual handling? Like everything else, if we want to work safe, we have to think and we have to plan. The best thing we can do is to avoid manual handling entirely. Take an example. We have to erect frames. Think about mechanisation and using handling aids. For example, we could use a crane. It may seem obvious, but that is the best way to eliminate the risk of manual handling injuries. Use machines. You can use a checklist to assess the risk of manual handling injury. We might find the risk of manual handling injury is greater if any of these issues are present. The tasks, do they involve holding loads away from the body, twisting, stooping, or reaching upwards, large vertical movement, long carrying distances, strenuous pushing or pulling, repetitive handling, insufficient rest or recovery time, a work rate imposed by a process. We might have assessed that there is a risk of manual handling injury. So, what can we do to control the risk? How can you make the work safer and easier? You can make the load lighter or less bulky, easier to grasp, more stable, less damaging to hold. We are all at risk of manual handling injuries, and they can be disabling, painful, and just plain inconvenient. But we can take control by working smart and planning and good investment. We can eliminate manual handling injuries. Employers have to provide personal protective equipment, and workers have to use the equipment. That includes you if you're self-employed.
The PPE requirements for working on site are pretty generic. Sunshine, exposure to the elements, that sort of stuff is standard. And working with power tools, electricity, things that cut timber or nail nails into them, again, you have to use the PPE required.
There are four areas of personal protective equipment to consider using. You may use safety harnesses. You need appropriate footwear, such as rubber-soled shoes, with non-slip tread, with or without steel caps. You should use eye protection, and you can consider using hearing protection. One of the long-term hazards is exposure to the sun. You should protect yourself every time you work outside. This means sunscreen, hats, and covers for your legs and arms. Clothing should be comfortable and not snag. All personal protective equipment should be regularly inspected and replaced where necessary. In certain situations, the spacing of the truss may exceed 600 mil centres, in which case other fall protection must be provided. You can use fall protection, including mobile scaffolding systems, complying with Australian standard AS1576 scaffolding part 1, general requirements, and part 3, prefabricated and tube and coupler scaffolding, and Australian standard AS4576 guidelines for scaffolding. You can use mesh or netting or fencing and handrails within adjacent trusses installed to the manufacturer's specifications. You can use elevating platforms, including motorised single-person lift platforms, complying with Australian standard AS14183.10. The people who wrote the safety standard have provided a useful checklist. If you ask yourself these questions honestly and take the appropriate action, you will be managing safety on your job.
A lot of questions were raised about the time that would take to do a lot of these things in a certain fashion. It seems that working with industry has helped in this manner, allowing to provide practical guidance that is actually realistic in safe erection trusses.
This way it uniforms the whole of Australia and everyone knows the standard practice.
The essence of using the code right means that the individual can do their job within a good time frame, make the money they need to make, and still come home at the end of the day.
Getting the roof trusses into a building is a satisfying milestone. The critical thing is to do it safely and efficiently. If you are organised, you'll save money and time and possibly a life. And that is worth all the thinking and all the effort.